So we decided that we needed to convene youth from across Canada with diverse backgrounds and experiences to really shed some light on how this this crisis is impacting you, how it's impacting your friends, and how it's impacting others within your circle. And then we said to ourselves, well, since we have you in the room, or this virtual room, we might as well ask you what you believe the youth workforce development sector could do to better support youth during this time as well. And that sort of speaks to the objectives of the summit, which is really about creating a space and a place for young people to share their experience during the COVID-19 crisis, while also sharing on some ideas, at least, on specific interventions that you'd want to see. So really quickly, before we actually hop into the youth panel, I want to just share, just give a bit of a run of show for how the summit is going to look. So we've divided it into three segments. The first segment is Youth Voice, and this is where we're going to be giving the youth panelists, I should say, an opportunity to really share what their experience has been with this COVID-19 crisis. We have a phenomenal lineup of young people, again, from across Canada, very diverse backgrounds, that are going to be able to shed some light on their experience here. And then the second segment is what we're calling the sector voice. So during this segment, we'll have our industry experts share what their organization is doing really support young people during this time, and then also maybe sharing any kind of sectoral insights that they feel young people should know at this particular time as well. And then the very last segment that we'll focus on is what we're calling youth ideas. And so this is really where we need to harness the creative prowess of you young people out there. How can the youth workforce development sector better support you during this time? And we really want to hear from the young people.
Hi, everyone. My name is Shell Hines. I'm the founder of Helping Hands, a youth civic engagement organization. I think right now I'm in a very weird place where both, you know, I'm a youth and I have the challenges that come along with that. But as well as I'm an employer at my nonprofit, I actually hire young people. And for us, we've been heavily, heavily impacted. We both had co-op students who their schools pulled them from their placement, which meant that the employment burden of taking care of our clients to be distributed to everyone else, as well as having to deal with the fact that we do work in schools. So at Helping Hands, we go into schools, we do workshops, and obviously with the schools being closed, means that we can't do our workshops in the traditional sense. And a lot of times we were trying to get some income from schools, charging schools, so that now we don't have that income, which means I can't use that to continue hire to young people. So for us, it's very interesting to be in both places where we're being impacted through the ability not to be able to do our workshops. We've transitioned to trying to do them online. We actually have been a remote organization for a while, recognizing that a lot of young people have employment barriers, so we allow people to work from home. So for us, that transition has been quite easy, but there's still a lot of challenges, and I'm definitely looking forward to kind of getting more into that.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jessica, and I currently work with the Women Abuse Council out in Toronto, which is lovely. I do have to say that I think I've been pretty privileged in that my organization has sort of worked in a virtual capacity in the past, and so the transition wasn't that difficult. But I think to Janelle's point around working in the gig economy and working part-time, I also teach kickboxing part-time, which is great, but unfortunately the studio had to close because of COVID, and so I've also sort of lost out on some of that income potential, which is unfortunate. And, you know, it was helping to pay off the OSAP, which was great. So I think, like Janelle said, unfortunately, I don't think I'd be sort of qualified for some of the income supports that are offered from the federal government, or even that have been proposed by the provincial government. And an ultra personal note, I live with my two grandparents and my sister, who has lots of severe health implications should she impact COVID. So Going outside right now is kind of scary for me because I super fear going out and contracting COVID, unfortunately, and then bringing that home to my family, who would be extremely susceptible to really the more dangerous end of COVID.
I'm a grade 12 student. I live in Toronto. How this COVID has impacted me. It's impacted me in a numerous amount of ways. It's affected my schooling and my work and just my personal life in general. So with school, I was in school until 2 weeks ago, and then all of a sudden I wasn't allowed to go back. School was put off till, I believe, April 6th, and now it's been put off till May 4th because of this virus. And so it leaves me wondering, as a grade 12 senior in my last 3 months of school, what is going to be my, where am I going to go after this? Am I going to graduate in June? How is my post-secondary going to be affected by this? What will my marks look like when I come back? No online school has been set up yet, so there's nothing to go off of. There's no substance to any of my courses. I'm losing, excuse me, 2 to 3 months of my courses. So it's just a huge loss in the sense of education. And so it gives me a sense of uncertainty, which I'm sure all other youth that are in their last year of school, like, what is going to happen to us? Like, what will happen when we go back to school and all of a sudden we're supposed to finish the semester in a month? How are we going to finish 2 to 3 months of schooling in 1 month, right? So that's just a negative impact of COVID on my life.
We're working for the City of Toronto as a staffer in a city councillor's office. So I guess speaking from my micro role in the city, it hasn't shifted our job too much. Similar to Janelle and Jessica, we've been lucky that our team has been able to shift to being work from home for the most part. And I think on a larger scale, it's shifted our scope of work. I think everyone assumes that as a city staffer, especially a staffer that works in the city councilor's office, we have all the answers to COVID and when's a vaccine coming out and when are we finishing with quarantine. And the answer is it's taught us really how to operate in a position of ambiguity. The situation changes very, very quickly. I'd say it changes hourly even. And so for us to even try to answer that question as city staff or anyone in the city or at any level of government, we actually don't have those answers. And what I'm realizing very quickly as a new member of the workforce is that we're fairly reactive. I think every sector has been reactive and we didn't plan well for this. And I can't speak to what it was during SARS prior to this, but I don't think any sector was expecting to attempt to adapt. But I've been lucky. It hasn't impacted my primary income in any capacity. It hasn't impacted any of my quality of work. We have a morning call every single day, and our team is very, very good at adapting, and so we've done well on that aspect. Where it's affected me on arm's reach is that I've had friends and people that I know who are graduating this year, and their offers have been rescinded. And so I just want to say, like, if you're someone out there that is in the workforce in a position like mine where you're a new graduate and you're lucky enough that your employment is still continuing for the foreseeable future, help out those new graduates, help out those neat young people that you know and that you come into contact with in your capacity. And also one of the things I'd like to say to those neat young people and to young people who are looking for employment or between employment right now, keep trying. It's like, get on those virtual coffee chats. I've been on a couple of virtual coffee chats. People are here more than happy to help out, more than happy to jump on the phone anytime. And I saw a comment from Jessica saying that you're self-employed and you're a grant writer for organizations. That's my secondary line of income. I work with nonprofits in the consulting capacity. This is temporary. This is going to go away in, I'd say, about 3 or 4 months. So stick in there. And I would also look at the CERB, the Canadian Emergency Response Benefit, that's going to be launching on Monday for self-employed individuals.
So my name's Wei, and I'm a startup founder for a supply chain technology company. We're essentially in the essential workforce right now. So far, how COVID-19 has affected us is that, I'm literally pulling a lot of extra hours into work. Most of them aren't really for profit because it's mostly putting out fires and handling disruptions in supply chain. The takeaway from this is I think of a lot of the challenges I had to face when I first came to Canada and when I first had to learn a new language pretty much in isolation as well. It's been a bit of a hurdle, and I think of this as a baptism by fire. If we can pull through this as an individual, regardless whether you're currently unemployed or not, it's like we can deal with a lot bigger challenges down the road. The first week when Vancouver declared a state of emergency, that I was in a coffee shop, and there was this business owner who was very bitter about how a lot of businesses are being shut down. And he was being rude. He was like, I'm not going to honor the discount because I don't even have enough customers. Now, that said, there are also a lot of, I've also met a lot of other startup and business owners who are just my age as well and who are seeing this as an opportunity to help and actually put their biggest skill sets and contribute that towards helping procure personal protective equipment for hospitals. So there are two sides of this, and there are two ways of how we see it. And the way I see it is that, COVID is not going to go away. We have to go through this. You may as well start fighting and hit the ground and run and get going instead of sitting on sidelines and complaining. The other thing I want to bring up is if you're unemployed, this is also a great opportunity to see it as a way to kind of try something new, take a new online course, or even if you're into starting up your own business, try to connect with people on LinkedIn because it's just the fact that there are so many other people who are unemployed right now. It's a great opportunity to meet other people, whereas in normal times, it would be very impossible just to get an information interview and sit down with someone who's more experienced than you are in the industry.
Hi everyone, my name is Haban Ali. I'm a senior student at the University of Toronto, Mississauga, and I'm currently finishing my bachelor's degree in environmental science and biology. I'm also a member of the Prime Minister's Youth Council, and I currently work at the university at the University of Toronto, Mississauga Students Union as the Vice President of Equity. COVID-19 has been incredibly hard to process for myself. Like it just, to the scale that it became, over-encompassing of our whole lives. I think it's been hard for me to grapple with that. I also have family members who are immunocompromised, so there's been a lot of fear and anxiety, understandably, so I'm learning how to navigate those emotions. I'm in my final year of school, and a year that's supposed to be full of celebration and transition is marked by a lot of uncertainty, and you know, I'm in some courses, and we're expected to be working at our full capacity, doing group work, submitting assignments while dealing with the pandemic, and maybe I'll get to graduate, but perhaps we'll be on Zoom, so we'll figure that out. And one thing I'm really concerned about is anti-Asian discrimination and racism that we've been seeing on our campuses. It started well before we saw COVID cases in Canada, and it was impacting students in a great deal in the way that they were going to their lectures, taking the TTC or the My Way, and it's so disheartening. And I think that the racialization of this virus is something that we don't talk about enough. And if you see something, please call it out because it's not okay. And another thing that has been sort of irritating me is the narrative that COVID is an equalizer. COVID is not an equalizer. That's not true, quite frankly. And we need to stop romanticizing this pandemic. The truth is that marginalized and vulnerable communities and populations who don't have access to job or wage security, who are homeless, who are out of work, who are incarcerated or immunocompromised are going to be disproportionately impacted by this pandemic. And what I think is absolutely incredible about this situation is that it actually forces us to acknowledge each other's humanity. And for better or for worse, our inequality is on full display. And this inequality is a result of years of poor policies and funding into communities who are on the sidelines. So I think the silver lining is that these communities cannot be forgotten anymore. They cannot be willfully ignored. And hopefully social investments will be made so we can build more resilient neighborhoods, communities, nations, and a world. So that's what's keeping me hopeful during this time, is to see how people are coming together.
I'm from Spaganagiti First Nation. I'm Mi'kmaq. I'm the granddaughter of residential school survivors. I currently reside in Halifax, Nova Scotia. I am an upper year student at Dalhousie University studying therapeutic recreation. I am the founder as well as of a mental wellness art program called HEART for youth by youth in Nova Scotia. The pandemic has impacted me in various ways. Of course, like everybody else has already said, my schooling has been impacted. We quickly moved to distance learning. My work has been impacted and my hours have been cut because the work just isn't there. A lot of the work I do with the young people are directing community or in their schools. So of course, social distancing, that work isn't there. But aside from all that, what's been impacted the most for me is my mental health. I thrive in helping other people. From a young age, the elders in my community have shared with me that my calling is to help other people. That's what I've been put on this earth to do. I like to be busy serving others. It's what's pushed me in my degree. It's what brings me joy in working in community youth development, and it's what calls me to volunteer each week with younger youth. I like to be busy. Being busy and that call to help others is the fire that pushes me through my degree. It's the fire that keeps me at work till 9 p.m. running youth programs and then home writing a paper and then writing craft and then prepping crafts for the kids. The helping others is what pushes me the most. Not being able to help others is actually hurting me. It's causing my anxiety and my mood, my anxiety to increase and my mood to plummet. I want to respond to the needs of my community. I want to be able to do more, but it took me some time to even be able to think about what I could do. I had to really grieve the loss of the connection that I had with people in my life that has been shifted. And then I had to also grieve for the world. There was a point when this all began that I would watch the news almost constantly. And now I can't. I can't even turn on the news anymore. It stresses me out and brings me way too much sadness. I miss the youth I work with dearly, as I know this is impacting them too. And they're all younger than me, but they're impacted. And I'm really worried about them, and I just want to find ways to offer them connection while myself trying to navigate this time, but while constantly being aware of the barriers and privileges that we all hold. So it's great to like offer Zoom meetings, but what if one of your young people in your life or youth don't have that access to internet or don't have access to a computer? For the younger youth, some of them are really, the youngest youth I work with are actually 5. And so how do you connect with a 5-year-old? Zoom is not the way that they connect. You can put them on it, they'll do silly faces, but they don't really connect. So what I've been doing with them is actually handwrote them all letters and gave them all pen pals. The right 27 letters, but I mailed them so that they would get something addressed to them and so that they would feel special. And for my older youth, as I mentioned, we're navigating the possibility of doing Zoom calls and doing art and mindfulness with them over Zoom, but that is, I'm constantly worried that I'm going to offer this and have a young person who really wants to engage but can't, and I'm trying to navigate how do you do that. But I'm also struggling with, I feel like I'm not doing enough and I want to do more. I know I should be doing more, but I suffer myself with underlying respiratory conditions. So I can't really leave my house. So I'm kind of bound to what I can do at home through screens. And that doesn't feel like enough right now. And I know a lot of like other young people are probably also feeling that they're not doing enough. But in reality, we all are doing enough. We're all doing our best. I think of people who are trying to homeschool or people who are trying to navigate online learning for the first time. Everybody's doing the best they can do. And I think we need to remember that and treat each other with that kindness and give ourselves that kindness that we're all doing the best we can do. Nobody planned for this. Nobody knows how to navigate this. This is new. And And I need everybody to give themselves a break.